session of Guru Manthan 2020. On this, the 74th Independence Day that we are celebrating. And the Guru Manthan 2020 is a series of ...50 discussions with educationists and thinkers. It happens every Saturday, 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. And we have started from the 1st of August, 2020. A very brief introduction to VLEAD. The VLEAD is the Vivekananda Institute for Leadership Development. VLEAD is an initiative of the Swami Vivekananda Youth Movement, and its mission is to develop human and social capital for nation building by enhancing the potential of individuals and institutions across the development sector. VLEAD engages across four sectors: the government, NGOs, corporates, and the community. This particular series, the Guru Manthan series, is a platform specifically for teachers, particularly during this COVID period, where for them to share, discuss, debate, learn about diverse perspectives and practices in education from across the world. This is going to be a series, like I said, of 50 lectures and interactions with educationist thinkers, and it's going to happen every Saturday over the next, so we have 47 sessions more to go. We started our discussions, we had a very inspiring talk by Dr. Gururaj Karjagi. Professor M.K. Sridhar's discussion was extremely informative, and today it's a privilege and pleasure to have Sri T.S. Krishnamurthy, former Chief Election Commissioner, who's going to be talking to us today. And today's session is going to be about the role of teachers in elections, experiential learning and democracy, and like we all know, it's happening on the 74th Independence Day that this is happening. And the format for the participants here is that the guest speaker would speak for about 20-25 minutes. That will be followed by a moderated Q&A session that I and my colleague Praveen Kumar, who is the Deputy CEO of SVYM, would be moderating. And then that will be followed by a concluding closing remarks by the chief speaker for about 10 to 15 minutes. That's going to be the session. I would now like to hand over the session, the introduction of the speaker for today, to Dr. R. Balasubramaniam, founder SVYM and Gram, who will introduce our esteemed guest speaker today.
Good evening and good evening to all of you, and wish you all a very happy Independence Day today. It's a great pleasure and a privilege to be introducing someone as accomplished and as well-known as Sri Krishnamurthy. It's very rare in the Indian administrative scenario for somebody like me who follows policy, politics, and administration. I always have spoken about and written about the stranglehold of the Indian bureaucracy, especially by the administrative services. You know, there's always the IAS, which believes that certain key positions should only be occupied by them, and they are the only ones who can think through running this country. I think the first person who actually broke this thinking and demonstrated that administration is not the monopoly of just the IAS, was extraordinarily demonstrated it, was our own Sir Sri Krishnamurthy. He was from the Indian Revenue Service, has held several senior administrative positions in government, and I have heard so many stories about him, which I don't think I can share it here, of his integrity, of his commitment, his conviction, and his thinking of country first, irrespective of what the consequence of the decision might be. It is very rare to have somebody like that, even to know somebody like that. It's rarer to have somebody like that who actually made his thoughts on our electoral processes so very well known in his book. And you know, for me, it has been such a privilege to have known him, to have interacted with him, to have learned from him, and have read his book. And he was the Chief Election Commissioner, and most of us would know that for 4 to 5, he was Chief Election Commissioner. He saw the elections of one Prime Minister laying down office and the other Prime Minister taking over and running for this country for 10 years. So when Sri Vajpayee lost the elections and Sri Manmohan Singh's government was formed, Sri Krishnamurthy sir was the Chief Election Commissioner at that time. So he also reminded us that he did his graduation from Bangalore. I'm not sure if he did his post-graduation from Mysore University. If so, we can take a little claim of that also. And so it's a great privilege, sir, and an honor that we have the Independence Day lecture, today's lecture, to be given by you, somebody who so strongly believed in democracy and all that India stands for. And if I can remember the name of the book, I think, was it Making Elections, sir? What is the, I'm trying to...
Miracle of Democracy, India's Amazing Journey.
It's a miracle of democracy, which India is a miracle of democracy. Sometimes in my own book, I have said India can be a very loud and noisy democracy.
Yeah.
It is our own CECs who have actually put some sense into it, given it some sanity, and they're so well known. In fact, sir has been well known in overseeing elections outside India too. And when the Supreme Court had to get the election of the BCCI overseen, he was the person who did it for us. So it's a privilege, sir, and we're looking forward to listening to you. Most of them would be teachers online, and these are people from across the state. Some of them might be outside. And, you know, whenever I interact with teachers, elections come, they always, you know, raise this issue saying that why are we the ones who have to be holding on to this election process in the villages, especially when we work in the villages. I strongly believe teachers are an inseparable part of democracy. And so I thought you talking about this would be so meaningful to all of us. So we're looking forward to a very engaging and enlightening session from you, sir. Welcome you once again. Thank you so much for responding to our request and being here today.
Thank you, Dr. Balu. Thank you, Mr. Praveen, and other members of the team. First of all, let me congratulate you for conducting this kind of a course for the teachers. I think it's a very useful and beneficial initiative. I would also like to convey my Independence Day greetings to all of you. It is very appropriate that we talk about elections on the Independence Day, because although we got independence in 1947, we became a republic in 1950, maybe nearly about 3 years later. A period was taken for formulating our own constitution, which is supposed to be the longest written constitution in the world. The beauty of the Indian constitution is that it has a beautiful blend of the British parliamentary democracy and the US presidential system. It has provided for checks and balances so that the parliament, the executive, that is the cabinet, and the judiciary, they all got certain specified checks so that nobody is able to overreach beyond their borders specified in the constitution itself. One of the unique features of the Indian constitution has been to mention the election commission as a part of the constitution itself. In no part of the world, in no constitution written or unwritten, the election commission has been given so much of importance as the Indian constitution has been given. So this is a very important point you have to note it down, because it gives a special status to the Indian election commission. So any change in the functioning of the election commission, particularly in the structure of the election commission, will have to be done only through an amendment of the constitution. The second point I would like to stress is, I'll briefly describe the features, then I'll talk about the role of the teachers in the election. The second important feature of the Indian Election Commission is when the election is announced by the Election Commission, until the result is announced by the Election Commission, no court can interfere with the proceedings of the Election Commission. If this provision has not been there, I am sure Indian elections would have been subject to chaotic consequences. In the US election, you must have seen many occasions they go to the court. And in one election, the Supreme Court of one of the particular, they have a Supreme Court in each state. One of the Supreme Courts of the state decided who is the winner. That kind of a situation doesn't arise in India. The Election Commission is the sole arbiter as far as the election, conduct of the elections is concerned. The result can be questioned in the court through a writ petition in the High Court and later on to the Supreme Court if necessary. This is the second important feature. The third important feature is the appointment of the election commissioners is mentioned again in the constitution. They are, the age limit is 65 years or 5 years is the term. And they are given the rank of a Supreme Court judge. The chief election commissioner can be removed only by impeachment. Although the intention was that all the election commissioners have to be removed by impeachment. Unfortunately, when the constitution was drafted, they did have only a chief election commissioner. And there is a provision for appointing as many election commissioners as may be necessary. But then over a period of time, you all know there was a confrontation between the election commission and the Prime Minister, namely Mr. Seshan and Mr. Narasimha Rao, during which time they passed an act bringing in two more constitutional members to the Election Commission. Initially, they were given only High Court judges rank, which was again questioned because Mr. Seshan said he had a Supreme Court judges rank and so he could boss over them. So that again, the law was amended to give them equal status so that all the three election commissioners have equal status and the chief election commissioner has got a first among equal status. And so he decides on important administrative issues relating to the election. Now, this is as far as the election commission is concerned. These are the important features. Now, the first Indian election commission was conducted in 1951-52. Mr. Sukumar Sen was the first chief election commissioner. And you may be surprised to know the first election was conducted. There was a ballot box for each candidate. And the voter had to go and put it in the particular ballot box. The vote, he has to cast his vote. So it was a manual voting. It was a ballot box for each candidate. But things have changed over a period of time. Now we have an electronic voting machine, which is only a single machine where the people can just press the button and cast their vote. Now, what is very important to note is the conduct of election is ensured by the Election Commission by number of procedures, the rules and regulations framed by them. They have the authority to, as far as the Supreme Court itself has mentioned in one of the judgments, that when there is a doubt and when there is a legislative vacuum, the Chief Election Commissioner cannot throw his hands in despair and then appeal to God for help. He has to take decisions, he has to conduct elections, and he has to ensure it is free and fair election. So the most important starting point for an
I think we seem to have had a mild connection issue there. So we'll just wait for Dr. Krishnamurthy to come back for a minute. I think we've lost him now. I think we lost the connection. I think we'll just wait for Mr. Krishnamurthy to join us back. In the meantime, if there are any questions that you specifically have with regard to the topic at hand, you probably would like to share it in or using the chat box or something and type it out.
Ramesh, sir will be joining back in a couple of minutes.
Okay.
We're very sorry for the cut in the disconnection in the internet. This is something which is unprecedented because Chennai is also a major city and we didn't expect this, but he'll be joining back shortly. But in the meanwhile, I know a lot of us teachers are here and most of the time, ಎಲೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ ಕೂಡಲೇ ಸಾಧಾರಣವಾಗಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಎಲೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಮಾತ್ರ ಅಲ್ಲ ನಮ್ಮ ಸರ್ಕಾರದಲ್ಲಿ ಗ್ರಾಮೀಣ ಪ್ರದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾವುದೇ ಚಟುವಟಿಕೆ ನಡಿಬೇಕಿದ್ರು ಕೂಡ ಅದು ಶಿಕ್ಷಕರ ನೆನಪಾಗದು ಅವರಿಗೆ ಅದು ಸರ್ವೆ ಇರಲಿ ಸೆನ್ಸಸ್ ಇರಲಿ ಎಲೆಕ್ಷನ್ಸ್ ಇರಲಿ ಯಾವುದೇ ಥರದ ಒಂದು ಜವಾಬ್ದಾರಿಯುತ ಕೆಲಸವಿರಲಿ ಅದು ಶಿಕ್ಷಕರ ನೆನಪಕ್ಕೆ ಬರೋದು ಎರಡು ಥರದ ದೃಷ್ಟಿಕೋನ ಇದೆ ಕೆಲವು ಸ್ನೇಹಿತರು ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ ಏನ್ ಸರ್ ನಾವು ಸುಮ್ಮನೆ ಕೆಲಸಕ್ಕೆ ನಾವು ಸಿಗ್ತೀವಿ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ಒತ್ತಾಯಿಸಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಕೈಯಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾಡಿಸ್ತಾರೆ ಅಂತ ಒಂದು ದೃಷ್ಟಿಕೋನ ಬಟ್ ನನಗೆ ಕೆಲವು ನಿವಲ ಆ ದೃಷ್ಟಿಕೋನ ಕೆಲವರಿಗೆ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಬಟ್ ನನ್ನ ದೃಷ್ಟಿಕೋನ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ವ್ಯತ್ಯಾಸವಾದದ್ದು. ನನ್ನ ಭಾವನೆ ಬಹುಶಃ ನಾನು ಹೇಗೆ ನೋಡ್ತೀನಿ ಅಂದ್ರೆ, ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ಶಿಕ್ಷಕರ ಪಾತ್ರ ಸಮಾಜ ಬರೀ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣದ ಕ್ಷೇತ್ರದಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾತ್ರ ಅಲ್ಲ, ಸಮಾಜವನ್ನ ಕಟ್ಟುವುದಲ್ಲೂ ಕೂಡ ಬಹಳ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಅಮೂಲ್ಯವಾದ ಪಾತ್ರ ಇದೆ. ಸೊ ಸಮಾಜ ಕಟ್ಟುವಂತ ಪ್ರಕ್ರಿಯೆಗಳು ಏನೇನ್ ಬರುತ್ತೋ ಎಲ್ಲದಲ್ಲೂ ಯಾರು ವಿಶ್ವಾಸವನ್ನು ಉಳಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡು ನಂಬಿಕೆಯನ್ನ ಇನ್ನು ಉಳಿಸ್ಕೊಂಡು ಬೆಳೆಸ್ಕೊಂಡು ಜವಾಬ್ದಾರಿತ್ವ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡ್ಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಅವ್ರು ಮಾತ್ರ ಮಾಡ್ಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಅಂತ. ಸೊ ಇದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಮುಂದೆ ಸರ್ ಕೃಷ್ಣಮೂರ್ತಿ ಸರ್ ಜಾಯಿನ್ ಆಗಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಅವ್ರು ಕಂಟಿನ್ಯೂ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ.
I'm sorry that there was a disconnection of the internet, and I hope you're able to hear me now.
Yes, sir.
Both, in many countries, if the government employees are drafted for the purpose of preparing the voter register as well as conduct of the elections. In some countries, it is given, option is given to public to join as volunteers, but most of the Commonwealth countries, the practice has been to enlist government servants, because if there is any irregularity, action could be taken against the person who is in the government. Whereas if he is a public member of the public, action may not be able to, we may not be able to take it quickly in any case. So that is the reason why public servants are used for the purpose of conduct of elections. Why teachers? That is the question. Well, traditionally it has been found that the teachers have been doing a yeoman service in the matter of conduct of elections. But I do agree that probably the teachers in higher schools could be avoided, so that there is no disruption of the education at the higher school levels. But elementary and primary, as well as in the middle level schools, it is good that the teachers are enlisted, because the state teachers can be relied upon for the credibility of the election. Although there have been situations when the political parties have questioned the manning of polling booths by government servants or by the teachers. In fact, there have been instances, for example, in West Bengal, the then Chief Minister, Mr. Jyotirmay Basu, questioned our bringing some outside people into the state, because we thought we'll give some credibility. There was a doubt sometimes that the polling officials were prejudiced in favor, or they were afraid of being independent. So we thought we'll bring some outsiders. So he wrote to me saying that you cannot bring outsiders into the polling booths. So I replied to him saying that I am not bringing foreigners into the polling station. I am bringing Bengali knowing officers who will be familiar with the voter roll, both in Bengali, because normally the voter roll is in local language and English. So it is easy for us to know, have the person knowing the local language. So we have brought only people from adjacent states to improve the credibility of your election. I'm afraid that your questioning this may not hold water. Of course, he didn't reply to me later. So there have been many occasions when sometimes the political parties have questioned the local people being used. But as I mentioned, the local people have knowledge of the local language. They are also aware of the local conditions, so it may be easy to employ them. And so we generally prefer the teachers to man the election. For example, in Kashmir, when we conducted the election, we used to take teachers from Urdu knowing teachers from Uttar Pradesh, and we used them again to improve the credibility of the election, because the local people may have a tendency, either they may be afraid of taking decisions, or they may be under certain influences. So we try to bring some credibility from bringing sometimes outsiders. But the point is, the teachers have rendered a yeoman service, and many Commonwealth countries, they regularly use the teachers for this purpose. And that is the reason why we have been doing it. The second thing is, as I said, the preparation of voter roll or the conduct of election is a very important task in the conduct of elections. You know, the main purpose of conducting election, or the first step of election democracy, is to have a proper election. If the elections are rigged, you have a problem. You cannot, not only have persons who are not good or credible representatives of the people, you also allow irregularities to steep in. The elections can be questioned in a high court by a writ petition, and it is very important that the preparation of the voter roll and the conduct of election is done by very responsible people. And that is mainly the reason why we have been entrusting this to state government and suggesting to them as much as possible to use the teachers. But I entirely agree with the view that as far as possible, we try to avoid the teachers in the higher classes, so so that their classes are not, or their schedule is not disrupted. Now, elections, conduct of election is not merely, conduct of election does not stop with just the day the election is conducted. It goes beyond that. The results have to be announced. Then the results can be questioned in a court of law after that. So a writ petition could be filed. And then the list of winners in the election have to be prepared by the election commission. Again, the presiding officers in the polling station, he gives the certificate about the number of votes polled, etc. And then the counting stations also, teachers are used, or some state government officials are used. There also, it is all, you know, watched by people. One of the things you have to bear in mind is that the conduct of elections is watched by one and all. It is not, it is so transparent that any mistake or any irregularity can be questioned, can be not only questioned before the election commission, not before the district electoral officer or the presiding officer in the polling booths. So these are open to, you know, criticism. So it is very important that you as teachers play a very important role. You have a lot of manuals prepared by the election commission. It gives what are the steps to be followed. The election commission also gives them training well before the election in each state, both vernacular, use of vernacular training as well as training in English wherever it is necessary. Then the use of electronic voting machines is also, you know, brought to the, is given, people are given training in use of that machine, because sometimes they may not know the intricacies of how the machine works. And in fact, the conduct of elections now is much more organized, much more technical than the conduct of elections maybe about 30, 40 years back. You know, in the first two or three elections, it was not very difficult to conduct elections because more or less a single party was ruling both the center and the states. But it, from 1969 onwards, there was a change. A lot of regional parties and different parties came to power. So all the more, the credibility of the election, conduct of the election, is a very important factor in assuring a good democracy in this country. So I just want to say that we all play a very important role. Second important aspect as teacher you have is, you have a duty to teach the Indian students about the quality of Indian democracy, the procedures to be followed. For example, in Australia, they have a museum where they take the students and show how the electoral steps are followed, how the registration is done, how the voting is done, how the counting is done, etc. So as teachers, you may have a responsibility to impress upon the students when they become major. As you know, in India, people vote from the 18th year onwards, and it's quite likely the college teachers have a responsibility to tell them that election, exercise of a voting right is an important right, and conduct of election peacefully, fairly, and freely is again an important requirement of a good democracy. So over a period of time, I think the technique of conducting the election has changed. There are a number of instructions the election commission has brought out, publication, they are available in the website, and I think they are also given when the teachers are enlisted. They are told how, what are the rules to be followed, circulars, brochures, they are all circulated, and people are also educated on this. So whenever, for example, when you are manning a polling station and you have a doubt, what is the system to be followed, whom should be referred, there is a chief electoral officer in each state. When the election is conducted only for the state, the procedure is slightly different. When the election is conducted by the, for the state central parliament, the procedure is slightly different, because we have to periodically keep the public informed of the steps taken in ensuring free and fair elections. So I would only say that apart from your duty in ensuring the credibility of the elections, you have a responsibility as educators to bring it to the knowledge of the students, particularly those who are above 15 and onwards, how the election system works in this country and how the system has worked over a period of time fairly successfully. And I thought I will also mention to you that India is the only country in the in the subcontinent, around the subcontinent, the country which has conducted elections continuously, there has been no gap between one election and another, in the sense that the parliament, the transition of power takes place peacefully through an election process. You take any of our neighbors, whether it is Pakistan, Sri Lanka, Nepal, Bangladesh, nowhere has it been as smooth as it has been in India. And I think the credit goes as much to the election commission as to the people who are in the polling booths, the central paramilitary forces who guard the polling stations. And I think over a period of time, we have acquired an established name, and there are a number of countries which seek assistance from India in ensuring proper procedure for conduct of elections. So I thought briefly I have described the way in which the elections are conducted, the way in which the teachers play a very important role in the conduct of elections. And I think I'll be open to any question thereafter on the procedures we followed, because there are, as I told you, there are manuals published. These are on the website of the Election Commission. And if you have any doubts, you can certainly refer to the district election officer, who is the collector generally. And if he is unable to save you, help you, there are observers who are sent to each constituency by the Election Commission. The observers are two kinds. One is an administrative observer, the other one is an expenditure observer. They have a different role to play, but they can clarify. They can visit your polling station when the election takes place. And at that point of time, if you have anything to be clarified, you can contact them. Their numbers are circulated well in advance for all the election officers in the constituency. And so we have a fairly well-organized system now, although technically we are still improving matters. So for example, the electronic voting machine is a big boom to the conduct of elections in this country, because previously it used to be ballot paper where a lot of irregularities used to take place. We know cases where bogus ballot papers used to be printed, and then even the polling official used to be threatened. Then someone from the party, whichever party it is, will go and stuff the ballot papers in the ballot box. Now, we had one case with that. I think I'll close it. In Bihar, we had to conduct an election again. We call it as countermanding the election. That is normally the Brahmastra of the Election Commission. If an election, there is a reason to believe that the procedures have not been complied with, Election Commission countermands the election and conducts it again. It has the power to do that. In that particular election, in the constituency Chapra in Bihar, where we had a lot of complaints that bogus people were allowed to go into the polling station and then exercise their vote. Now, this is something which is certainly not acceptable. I don't know whether the polling officials were threatened by the local people or gundas or what it is, but we found a lot of irregularities. We opened up the books, we saw the registers, and we found many irregularities had been taken place. We passed a speaking order countermanding the election. And I'm mentioning this only from the point of view of the fact that if there are irregularities, there are always questions asked, and the Election Commission has a responsibility to answer those questions and, if necessary, countermand the elections. So you play a very important role, and I would like to appeal to all the teachers to understand the procedures well, so that if there is any irregularity, you may have to explain why that irregularity took place. So with these words, I'll conclude my preliminary remarks, and I'll be very happy to receive any questions.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for that introductory presentation. I think one of the questions that has come up, and also something that, maybe there are also some questions that Praveen is getting there, when you've spoken about it very clearly that, you know, teachers are and play a very important role in the entire process of conduct of elections itself. From viewing it from the other side, there seems to be, you know, a lot of, I've read about this also, there seems to be a lot of reluctance in the teacher fraternity in terms of actually going in for election duty. So do you think there needs to be a more structured and organized kind of an orientation training program that ensures that, you know, teachers voluntarily become part of this process of...
I can understand the reluctance on the part of some of the teachers in some states, not necessarily in all states, because in some states where violence or, you know, violence and hatred prevail during the election time, there is a threat to their lives also. There is a threat to their physical well-being. So it is true that in some places, there is a reluctance to participate in the elections. But I think over a period of time, with the paramilitary forces available all over the constituencies, all over the election time, and you know, nobody can, no non-voter can come except the authorized officials between 100 meters from the polling station. There is more safety now than probably it was there earlier. But as far as reform is concerned, I do agree that it is possible to bring some reform in this regard. Maybe we can have a separate panel of people who are volunteering to do this work instead of forcing them to do the work. But then here again, you know, we have about nearly 1 million polling stations in this country. And there are some polling stations where Naxalite infested areas, you may have to go by aircraft, be there for the time and then come back. So there are certain difficulties in getting people on a voluntary basis. So while it is necessary to bring in training, maybe quality of training may can be improved. In addition to that, we may have to provide extra protection for these people. In fact, in the Kashmir elections, for example, we did tell them, apart from protecting them, etc., that if there is anybody who is, you know, subject to any violence, injury or death, we will fully insure them. Not the normal insurance. They were treated almost like police or army people who were killed during the action. So some protection is given. But I agree that over a period of time, we may have to think of bringing in a new system whereby there are, you know, there is less reluctance on the part of the people who are coming to poll the, to man the polling stations.
So just to add to Ramesh's question, one of the things also raised by the teachers is while we know that teachers' presence brings credibility to the entire process, in terms of the policies, like if we take the Right to Education Act, the act itself kind of says that teachers should not be involved in any non-academic works other than any relief work during disasters or only the 10-year census. But we don't seem to be talking about it openly, saying that teachers play a crucial role in the electoral process. Any comments on that?
Well, I agree that obviously we have probably not done much of a publicity on this aspect of the function of the teachers. But I do agree that you cannot be using the teachers for every election. Particularly, we use teachers only because the elections are generally conducted when the schools are closed. You know, the general elections in India, at least in the last few elections, they have always been conducted in April and May. Because we need the schools, for most of the polling stations are in the schools. So we need the school. That is the reason we ensure that the schools are closed and they are not actively engaged. Of course, there may be some people who are rallying the papers, etc. I agree that such problems will be there. I think we may have to have a proper correspondence between the state government, the teaching fraternity, and then arrive at some workable compromise. But we can have a mix. We need not have only teachers for this job. We can have a mix of teachers and non-teachers. We can also invite public to volunteer themselves. But the only difficulty we have in this is we may not be able to have control over public in case they indulge in any irregularity. We can only file an FIR and probably allow the court to take place. But when the teachers are state government employees, they are subject to certain discipline. The Supreme Court has given a direction that if there are any irregularities noticed during the election time and indulged by those people who are manning the election, including the state government servant, we can bring it to the notice of the state government for appropriate action. So this is the main reason why the state government officials are being used. But I do agree that there is a time has come now probably to have a mix of teachers and non-teachers. And maybe here again that we give as much to the people who are volunteering to do the work. And also probably make it more lucrative for the teachers, because I know there are sometimes complaints that they don't get the payment in time. It takes maybe months or years in some cases. So we may have to do some improvement in that area.
There is a question specifically with regard to the electronic voting machines that you referred to. While I do understand, and given the size of the population, the convenience of the electronic voting machine, we have seen in the recent past quite a lot of conversations around the electronic voting machines should to be replaced by ballot papers, or at least the VPATs, where we at least get a confirmation, though it is done for some electro EVMs, not for all. I just wanted to get your thoughts on that in terms of the argument against EVMs, as well as the use of
electronic. First point is, I think electronic voting machines of India are a matter of national pride. They are manufactured in Bangalore and Hyderabad. Electronics Corporation of India, Hyderabad, and Bharat Electronics, they make all the machines. And there are inbuilt at least 15 to 20 safeguards in the machine. There is absolutely no scope for any misuse. But then political parties have a tendency to blame the machine when once they lose the election. And it may be of interest to know that two chief ministers, one chief minister of Punjab, another chief minister from Tamil Nadu, went up to the Supreme Court questioning the credibility of the electronic voting machines. The election commission participated in the proceedings and they said, we are willing to throw it open. Anybody can prove how it is not credible. The Supreme Court gave the opportunity to both the chief ministers and they said they cannot demonstrate. In fact, the Supreme Court said you demonstrated in the machines used by the election commission. They said that they have their own machines in which they will prove how it can be. For example, by remote control, you can operate, etc. The Supreme Court did not accept that argument. And it is very important to know that the DRDO in Bangalore had a committee, technical committee, to go through all these machines. And we also appointed a committee under an IIT director who submitted a report. He told me himself that He had given the task to about 50 electronic engineers all over the country to find out any possibility of misuse of the machine. They were allowed to break open the machine. They were allowed to go into any aspect of the machine. And none of them could find any defect in the machine. And for those who may be wanting to know, these two chief ministers who got elected in the next election, so through the electronic voting machine, they never talked about the irregularity in the election commission, in the electronic voting machine. So it is partly apprehension, partly political purpose in defaming the electronic voting machine. I have no hesitation in saying publicly, I have done it as election commissioner, as chief election commissioner, and also after retirement, that there is no need to doubt the integrity of these machines. In any case, in order to meet the apprehensions expressed by some parties, they introduced what is known as the VVPAT scheme, which has been used on a percentage basis in some of the polling booths. The question is whether you should have it in all the polling stations. Well, if that is the only way we can satisfy them, I have no objection. We should go ahead and have it. But it is unnecessarily waste of time and money on that. But if credibility has to be established, I have no hesitation in saying that go ahead and have VVPAT in all the polling in the electronic voting machine. But as for personally, having a person who have visited these factories, having understood the working of this machine, having seen the safeguards provided, these machines are not kept in one place. They're shifted from one place to another at the time of every election. For example, machine used in Bangalore or Mysore may not be there after the election. Only 6 months they keep the machine. If there is a writ petition filed, those machines are kept. All other machines are sent to another state. And secondly, before the conduct of election, there is a mock trial, mock election, where all the parties' representatives have a look at the machine, whether it works properly or not. So there are enough safeguards. But if the political parties still insist on having that, we have no problem. I think the Election Commission is willing to go ahead and have the VVPAT in all the polling stations. But it takes time because the machines have to be altered. And I think it's, as I say, the engineers in Bharat Electronics and engineers in Bharat Electronics Corporation deserve appreciation. They have done a commendable job. It's very cheap. It's not an expensive machine. And it has enough safeguards. But our political parties being political parties, I think we have to make them understand the importance of it. If necessary, give them the VVPAT in all the constituencies. But I will only assure all the people that if only we have the conventional system, there will be more frauds and irregularities. And if you want to improve, at least improve the machine, but not go back to the old ballot box system, which is probably a disaster if it is introduced.
So just taking your comments further, sir, there was a very interesting question from one of the teachers. Why not take it one step forward, have online elections?
Yes, in fact, we have considered this over a period of time. In fact, IIT Madras, one of the professors gave us a report as to how it could be considered. But the problem is political parties are not accepting it because the privacy of the vote will be open to challenge. Because if you ask somebody to allow them to vote from home, they will be under undue influence of the party or the family member and so on. It is actually an apprehension. Most of the educated people are not going to be influenced by others. But then the illiterate or the semi-literate people, they can be influenced. So there is an apprehension, but what I have suggested is the internet voting could be introduced in respect of senior citizens, handicapped persons, so that they don't have to come and stand in the queue to conduct the election, to cut the vote. So some categories, for example, the police officials who participate in the election duty, the diplomats who are abroad, these categories, and the armed services people who are at the border, they can all be allowed do internet voting. This is my personal view, but I think in the COVID time, they are examining the possibility of giving some kind of a benefit. As you know, they tried to give it for all senior citizens, but there was a protest. That measure has been withdrawn, internet voting for senior citizens. But now they have said only those above 80 can use the internet voting. But I think time has come, I mean, postal ballot, not internet voting. So postal ballot also is subject to undue influence. There are people who can force them to exercise the postal ballot also wrongly under the influence of the political parties. So in every system, there will be some problem. There will be some scope for irregularity. But then as we march on, the voting population is increasing in this country. We have to make the best use of technology, maybe in a graduated step so that you don't bring the change all of a sudden. Over a period of time, we have to bring. And I believe the time is not far off when internet voting will come, maybe after 20 years. But in the meantime, it can be tried on an experimental basis for certain sections of the voting population.
Thank you, sir. There are several questions which are coming in from teachers, and I think there is a deeper understanding which is sought with respect to the election process itself. So I wouldn't want to venture too much into that. Stick to the role of teachers in elections. There are a couple of very interesting questions which came up, talking about where they explained how in their schools where they have this election process and a student parliament being in place. But they are in a kind of a catch-22 situation when it comes to the educational qualifications.
Yeah.
When it comes to candidates in a general election in India, there seem to be no qualifications. But in a school, we tend to promote meritocracy. Any comments on that?
Yeah, in fact, this has been raised on many forums as to why we can't prescribe an educational qualification for the candidates contesting the elections. Normally, I would have said yes, we can have some qualifications. But if you look at the experiences of other countries will be surprised. For example, in Pakistan, there is a requirement a person should be a graduate when a person contests election. You know, all the madrasas gave certificate for whatever training they gave as the equivalent to graduate. And then the government accepted it, whether they were really qualified for that purpose or not. In fact, there was a lot of criticism by the Pakistani election observers that it has led into misuse of the system. Similarly, in India, we have a number of uneducated people who have shown uncanny common sense, and they have even done better in representing the people. So education in the modern or conventional sense sometimes may not be adequate to deal with the problems of representing a constituency. We have had some teachers, some ministers who have, ministers and even some chief ministers who have not even studied. For example, in Tamil Nadu, Mr. Kamaraj and Mr. Karunanidhi did not see beyond fourth or fifth class in the school. So there have, and Mr. Kamaraj particularly had an abundant common sense, and he was able to get the work done through the civil servants. So I'm not very sure whether education qualification is a must, but I believe that education qualification is a must for parliament, for the, ministers. Sometimes uneducated ministers enter into the cabinet. I believe, recently I saw one minister in Andhra, Telangana, is wanting to complete his school education. He's an education minister. So these anomalies or these ironies should be avoided as far as possible. I would say, why as far as possible? I would say it must be ensured that all ministers are educated. They understand the files when they come to them, the policy decision they take in a responsible manner. So education is a must for becoming a minister or a person with a parliamentary or legislative activity. But for contesting the elections, whether it should be made an important requirement is a debatable point. But maybe in course of time, when the quality of our teachers, quality of our candidates, political candidates improve, we will have more educated people coming into the electoral system. Even now, I am told those who are contesting elections, at least about 60-70% of them are graduates. The remaining persons are not graduates. But ultimately, it's the will of the people. And if the parliament amends the Representation of People's Act, it's fine. We have the election commission, we'll have no objection. But looking at the practicalities involved, maybe we'll have to wait for some more time when educational qualification is prescribed as a condition for contesting candidates. But personally, the election commission has no objection. It is open to the ideas. But only you look at it as a democratic right of an individual to contest election, whether we should prevent them or not. Maybe at least you can say minimum matriculation or 12th standard is necessary. I'm sure these things will happen, but when will it happen? I don't know when our parliamentarians and political leaders will take a view in this regard.
Thank you, sir. One of the issues that we seem to be noticing is the in the voting turnouts, particularly in the rural-urban divide, particularly in the younger population. There seems to be a greater turnout in the rural areas than in the urban groups. Particularly, there seems to be a disinterest in the, or rather a disdain for the electoral process itself among the urban youth. So I'll just club another question along with that. Do you think that it's some sort of a model or model elections within the urban setup, rural election, that helps children understand not just the process but also the philosophy and the importance of the entire democratic electoral process itself?
Firstly, I would say the Election Commission in the last few years has brought out a lot of literature material. They have been I think reaching the students, particularly the students' population, about the and about the importance of election, about the importance of democracy, and so on. But as far as the voter turnout is concerned, there is a view that if a person has got a right to vote, he has also a right not to vote. So if he doesn't come and vote, can we introduce a compulsory voting in India? In Australia, it is there. In Singapore, it is there. There's a compulsory voting. But now, is it possible to introduce it in India? Now, with 60 to 70% of the people voting, the remaining 30%, if they don't vote, I have to ask for explanation from the remaining 30%. Our constituencies are, particularly the parliamentary constituency, is little more than 3 lakhs of people. If it is 30%, means 90,000 people, I have to write issue notices, hear them, and take a decision whether I should levy a penalty. In Australia, almost 95% of the people come and vote, even before making it mandatory. So they have a problem with regard to a small segment of the voting population. Even there, they do not take it very seriously. They impose a monetary penalty and be done with it. Now, in India, if I do that, let us assume that for 30% we issue notices. We'll spend most of our time only on that. And secondly, these will be challenged in the court. So all these things, courts will be flooded with such petitions against such penalties. So whether it is possible to introduce compulsory voting, I won't. But in Gujarat, for example, for panchayat elections, they have introduced compulsory voting. Maybe panchayat and town corporation elections, and to some extent even state elections, we can consider whether, because the voting population is not substantial, we can take some action. But for a parliamentary constituency, to take action, to introduce compulsory voting, I think it's next to impossible as of now. If the turnout improves, and the Election Commission has been doing a tremendous job in publicizing the philosophy behind the election, the philosophy behind the periodical, the need to elect the right people, etc. They have been doing it. Maybe there is still some scope for improvement to reach every individual voter. Maybe they should get into some kind of a brochure, periodically send them, get some communications vamped up. All that is, I agree. But as of now, compulsory voting is not possible. As of now, the voting turnout of 60 to 65% is reasonably good. I won't say it's excellent, but as you said, in the urban areas, the voter turnout is less when compared to the rural area. Here again, there are some states, even urban areas, it's good. For example, Himachal Pradesh, then Rajasthan, these are some of the states where the voter turnout is above 80%. Maharashtra, Gujarat is over 70%. So these are some states where the turnout is better. The political parties should play a very constructive role in these matters, but they are all interested only in their own vote bank. They are not interested in all the people coming and exercising their vote, because there is a view in some political parties, if all the people come and vote, they may not get elected. So they are very happy that some people don't come to cast their vote. So there are very conflicting interests operating, and only if the quality of political parties improves in our country, there is some possibility of improvement of the voter turnout. But when compared to Western democracy, they are also not so good. Maybe Australia and Singapore are different. But if you go to UK or USA, it's not even 60% in some elections. So as of now, compulsory voting is not possible. The only way is to educate the voters. In fact, there is a recommendation that the election process should be taught in the high schools and colleges. So maybe these are some of the steps we may have to take to see that the younger generation takes more active interest and we get better quality candidates contesting the elections. Then the voters may come, because we introduce what is known as the nota, none of the above. That is, if a person is not interested in the candidates put up by various parties, they have a choice to exercise that nota right, so that their vote doesn't go waste, but they also ensure that it is not misused, and they express their discontent towards the candidates. We thought, in fact, the Election Commission supported.
We seem to have lost Krishnamurthy again. And we're just checking to see if I think it's
again it's broken.
Yeah.
I'll try to reach him on the phone.
just bear with us. I think these are this is not something that is normal, because we do a lot of these online programs and we've not had disconnects. But there is a first time for everything, I suppose. So I think this is the first time that we're having people getting disconnected twice.
We're sorry, I just reached out to him. His internet has again got disconnected. He said he's trying to reconnect. So Ramesh or Praveen could readmit him when he reconnects.
Yeah.
Anyway, like we were discussing before, a lot of wonderful points that Sir brought to all of us. I think it was excellent, especially some of you are actually, I know Bhagyalakshmi had raised a question about children and how they can be such a learning ground for them when you do school cabinet and school elections. So Sir has come back, and so I think he will continue taking it.
Yeah, forward. I'm sorry, again it got disconnected. I'm sorry about the disconnection.
No problem,
okay.
Sir. No problem.
Yeah. Any other questions?
Yes, sir. I think, in fact, you were discussing NOTA, which was, in fact, the question that we were, planning to ask you about. I think you touched upon NOTA. There's one other question that, that has been a question of hot debate. I think the last question for today would be your thoughts on the electoral bonds. There's been much discussion on that. So,
well, although it has nothing to do with the topic of the day, but I agree, electoral bonds is something which unfortunately is a wrong step taken by the government. I strongly believe that the electoral bonds is not a right step at all. It has given an opportunity for tainted money to be introduced in the electoral process through a process which I may call it as whitening process. You are, just because you are introducing the money through a bank, it does not absolve the responsibility of the government to ensure that good money comes into the election process. And I'm a strong critic of the electoral bonds. It should never have been introduced. And even now, in my opinion, it should be withdrawn if you really want the funding of elections to take place in a proper manner. I have given a suggestion to the government, to the Election Commission, which has been recommended to the government of India, that instead of having all this, you have a national election fund. And that money can be contributed by corporates as well as individuals directly, and they can be given 100% tax rebate for the money given. At the moment, they get a 50% tax rebate. The political parties can give, but they are reluctant to give openly, because if it is given to one party, there is another party which will find fault with them. So my own suggestion in this regard is to have a national election fund. The corporates and the individual should be given the option to donate the money to that fund. That money should be used for funding all the election of the candidates. The guidelines for use of that money can be drawn up in consultation with all the political parties. In fact, we have a system of allotting TV, state TV time, etc., for various political parties on the basis of a consensus arrived at by a conference of all political parties. So it is possible for a government to think of a national election fund, because if you allow parties to get money directly from the corporate individuals, you are opening the gates for a lot of controversy. The policy formulation gets affected, and the obnoxious nexus between the election, between the political parties and the corporates, results in distorted policy formulation. So they should not be given money to political parties. And political parties need not spend money for the election of the candidates. The money collected through a national election fund can be used. There may be shortages. The shortages initially may be met by the government. But if you give 100% tax exemption for these donations, monies will come from the corporates as well as individuals. And over a period of time, we can build enough money to conduct the election. Unfortunately, the ceilings that we have prescribed for various candidates are totally unrealistic. So there's a lot of cash expenditures taking place. And this electoral bond does not meet all this criticism. It only enables the parties to get money from unknown sources, and it is not a very desirable state of affairs. And what is necessary is to make it transparent. In US, for example, there is no restriction. Anybody can collect money, but they do it by party conventions when they have dinner tickets priced, and people can come and join, and they can they pay money and contribute it to the political party. They have no restrictions at all. But what is a consequence of that is enormous public expenditure, enormous funds being used in the election. If that happens, no poor person can contest election in India. So if you really want to bring independent, poor people, competent people to enter the election arena, it is necessary to do away with the present system, including the electoral bonds, and have a national election fund. I know there will be difficulties. These difficulties can be got over by suitable safeguards.
Thank you very much for your patient and, you know, very, very convincing answers to all those questions. I think we could go to your concluding remarks.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Dr. Balasubramaniam, Mr. Praveen, and Mr. Mesh, and other members of the team. I was delighted. I'm sorry for the slight interruptions because of the sudden loss of internet. But what I wish to say is, you know, there is a lot of need for awakening of the people, both in the exercise of their voting rights and also in regulating these political parties. One of the things I had recommended in 2004, and I've written it in my book, and I mention it even now, I'm writing some articles, I insist on having a separate law for political parties. There is no law for regulating the operation of the political parties. The Association for Democratic Reforms, one of the finest non-governmental organizations participating in the electoral improvement of the electoral system, has brought out a draft law. It was debated in a meeting headed by Mr. Justice Venkatachalaya, where we considered all the pros and cons. We suggested further changes, but unfortunately, no government has taken any initiative in bringing out a law for regulating the political parties. So if you really ask me, two areas where we can bring about good changes is to bring a law on political parties, bring a national election fund. The third one, if it is mentioned, is change the first-past-post system that we have. It is all right when the country got independence, when there was a lot of illiteracy in the country. It is probably time for us to consider the voting system, either proportional representation or a mixed system. There are a number of varieties available because we have a country with too many diversities, and your people getting elected, they come with the votes of 20 to 30% of the votes. They do not represent the remaining 70%. And many of them don't have national interest, they have the local interest. So if you really want for the parliament to improve the quality of its performance, the quality of democracy, there's a need for these three changes urgently. If it can be brought about, I think I'll be the happiest person.
It was a wonderful session, sir. Thank you so much for responding to our request and coming on online and helping us think through all these important things. I'm sure all the teachers are richly benefited. Now Ramesh and Praveen can formally sort of go towards the closure of the session.
It has been a pleasure, and thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. And it was absolute pleasure. I think there's much that we learned, all of us here. And we thank you once again. It was an honor to have you as part of this series, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
And for the teachers, do join us the next week. We will have Mr. Anurag Behar, who is the Vice Chancellor of the Azim Premji University and the CEO of the Azim Premji Foundation. He'll be talking about strengthening the education system in India, and specifically from the point of view of the role of teachers and the public education system. So do join in, and do send in your any comments, any questions. In fact, as the session was going on, I and Ramesh were discussing that we should ask sir to share a write-up on the electoral bonds for the teachers, because I have actually the clarity of thought about it is much needed.
In fact, I have just written a chapter for a book to be published soon. The title of the chapter is Indian Democracy, Is It Illiberal or Licentious? And there, I because most of the Western critics say that Indian democracy is illiberal. I don't think it is illiberal. It has too much of freedom in this country. Too licentious democracy that we have. Of course, the illiberal features are there, but it is more licentious. And when once probably it is approved for publication, I can share. But in the meantime, my other lectures or my other comments are available. I can send it across for you to circulate to the participants.
Thank you.
That would be very helpful, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. And may God bless you all.
Thank you so much, sir.
And I must say, Mr. Balasubramanian is doing a wonderful job in the Vivekananda Institute, which I had the privilege of visiting some years back.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
And for all the participants, thank you. Have a great evening. Have a great weekend. Also, you can, if you want to, this recording of this would be posted. Both the video would be available on YouTube. And we'll also shortly have the audio of this presentation that will go on our podcast channel as well. And you can also follow us on YouTube. You can just go to the WeLead channel. You can follow us on our podcast. We are available on Spotify and Anchor. So you can follow us there and also on our blog. And if you want, you could write to either Praveen or myself. You have our address. Thank you very much. Have a great weekend and hope to see you soon again next week. Thank you.
Best wishes. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.